Message contains a special offer for listeners of this station. Are you a man over 40? Are you constantly looking for the nearest bathroom? Do you wake up multiple times a night to use the bathroom? Right now, Perfect Prostate is sending out free bottles of their groundbreaking new formula to listeners of this station. Perfect Prostate formula was developed by medical doctor Mitchell Fleischer, and its ingredients have been clinically studied to reduce your frequent nighttime bathroom visits and promote healthy urine flow. Right now, preferred customers get their first bottle of Perfect Prostate absolutely free. There's nothing to lose. Perfect Prostate is guaranteed to reduce that constant urge to use the bathroom, especially at night, and promote healthy urine flow. Don't wait. Call now for your free bottle. Just pay shipping and processing. Dial 1-800-675-0251. That's 1-800-675-0251. Supplies are limited. One free bottle per household. Call now. Dial 1-800-675-0251. That's 1-800-675-0251.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
Every day, the men and women of the United States Marine Corps stand ready to defend the American way of life. The few, the proud, the Marines.
Hey folks, I want to introduce you to a friend of mine, Dr. Richard Hardin. We are on the same mission, which is waking up America. We just have different paths. So stay tuned for some information on how you can keep up with Richard and all his work.
Visit Richard's website at rahardin.com. That's the World Wide Web at rahardin.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Hardin to see and purchase.
Hello
his
there,
books.
This is Nat King Cole wishing you all a happy and a Merry Christmas.
The joy of living is in the giving. So let's give lots of toys for tots. Toys, toys, toys for tots. Some have too many, some haven't any. If those who have give those who haven't, oh, what a Christmas day. The Marine Reserve will help you, will help you fill your sleigh with lots and lots of toys for tots. So give a little toy today.
Since 1947, the United States Marine Corps has been helping Santa fill his sleigh, making happier holidays for deserving children right in your community. Go to toysfortots.org and learn how you can make a difference.
This is Rio of Madison Rising, and you're listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
The mainstream media is really the make-believe media. First, they make up the news, and then they make you believe it.
Hi, this is Susan Swift.
I'm highly successful, have been all my life. I have enjoyed successful careers in film, television, and law.
I'm Dan Wright, a father, a gun owner, a dog owner, and a Federalist.
I'm Susan Swift, and you are listening to Constitution and Culture on KLRN Radio.
Where liberty and reason still reign. Hey, good evening, everybody, and welcome to Constitution and Culture. New show we decided to put together for Wednesday nights on KLRN. It'll be me, I'm Dan Wright,
And I'm Susan Swift, and thanks for listening. This is exciting.
Yeah, I think it'll be great. Y'all probably or maybe know me from my Friday night show with Rick Robinson that I do, Robinson and Wright. And hopefully you know Susan. She did all the debate roundtables with us and the election coverage, and that's how we got to know each other and decided to put this thing together. How are you doing, Susan?
I'm doing great, Dan, and I'm excited to be on with you, but I wanted to find out a little bit more about you since I'm a little bit new here. So I want to ask you, how did you get started? For people who are just tuning in right now, tell them about you and how you got started at KLRN.
Well, I started doing I actually started just kind of guesting on friends' shows. Always loved radio and never really knew if I had the ability to do it, but always knew I had the ability to talk too much. and started guesting on friends shows, and it turned into a show I did for a while over on Blog Talk Radio, and then started regularly guesting with Rick. And one day he just said, hey, why don't we just turn Friday into our own show? And so we did that a few months ago, and it's been fairly successful.
What's the name of that show?
It's Robinson and Wright. Friday nights, 11 o'clock.
Awesome.
Tell us a little bit about you.
Well, I met you folks through the political process that America just went through in picking its new president. But before that, the way that I kind of came into radio was in 2009. I was very, very frustrated at our government and watching what was happening with Obamacare being rammed through the Senate and the House. And I was so furious that I didn't know what else to do other than pick up the phone. And I called into Rush Limbaugh's radio show. And I happened to get through. I was one of the lucky calls that made it through and spoke to, you know, Bo Snerdly, the screener, and then spoke directly to Rush Limbaugh. And I had such passion about that. And I was so furious at the party line way that these rabid dog liberals are just jamming their health control bill through the House and Senate on a party line vote and you know taking over 1/6 of our economy, that I just went for 20 minutes on Rush Limbaugh's show and he just sat back and let me. And apparently I was passionate enough and articulate enough that people thought it was interesting. And one of the people who was listening at the time was Andrew Breitbart. And as a lot of listeners may know, he had started up his big journalism and big government websites. They have now become Breitbart, the news, the epic internet news source that's, I guess, accused of being alt-right, who knows, but he was always a consummate agitator of the left because he himself had been a Democrat and then saw the light when he was working at the Huffington Post and he decided I can't do this anymore. And Andrew Breitbart heard my call into Rush Limbaugh and he said, that's news right now. That's happening right now live. I want to find her. And so they tracked me down and asked me, they interviewed me on, it was called the Breitbart B-Cast at the time. And I did a little segment on that. And I didn't even have a Facebook page at that time. And a friend of mine hunted me down and encouraged me to get a Facebook page and start making commentary just as, you know, out there and participating in the social media scene. And shortly that started leading to writing for big journalism. Breitbart invited me to be one of his writers for then the infant big journalism site. And I wrote for that big journalism and big government. And that eventually evolved into Breitbart. And shortly after the passing of Andrew Breitbart, which was really, it's a tragedy that we lost him. He's too young to go. When Steve Bannon took over, the site changed more into more news reporting. And I
I can't really do a lot of that because I am a mother and I have seven kids, and that is my job. That's my primary responsibility here on Earth, is to turn out seven decent little people so that they don't turn into hoodlums and problems for others. So I can't do what those Breitbart reporters do. And I now contribute for Politichicks. Anne Marie Murrell invited me to start contributing over there at Politichicks because I can offer my opinions and my conservative viewpoint, if you will, and take on many different political happenings during the day. So that's how I'm ending up at Politichicks. And now I also write and I contribute at the Conservative Firing Line. And then I was very honored that you would like to start this radio show here at KLRN. So it's really exciting for me.
Absolutely. I really thought, and I think you felt it too, that when we were doing those debate roundtables, and there were what I liked about it is there were some things during the election that you and I didn't agree on, and mm-hmm. we were able to have fantastic civil discussion on it, which I don't seem to be able to get
fantastic
in some other
civil
places.
Yes. These yes. are ideas where we're not calling each other names. I am so sick and tired of the liberal media. You know you have them when they start saying, well, yeah, but you're racist, or yeah. well, yeah, but that's stupid, or what. I mean, they immediately go to name calling, and you're like, could you just time out and just talk about the issue that I just brought up, the question, whatever it was? And they're like, yeah, well, that's because you're white, or you're a woman, or whatever. And they go off on it, and they start calling you names, and you go, well, I think I won that debate. That's how you know, because they immediately go to that. They cannot defend their ideology. Our job is to put them on the defensive and make them go through the steps in hopes of saving them. I really look at this as almost an evangelical outreach to these poor, misguided liberals who really, truly, most of them, they don't know any better. I mean, the ideologues do, but the your regular run-of-the-mill Democrat who's been voting Democrat all his life and it just kind of has liberal ideas bouncing around in his head, God bless him, he doesn't even know any better. And what you have to do is you have to challenge them intellectually and walk them through and say, but why do you believe that? What is that? Please defend your idea on this, and so that we can have a civil discussion. That's what I like, and I can be persuaded. I'm coachable, and if you can explain to me where I'm wrong on something, or I didn't have the facts, or something has changed, okay, I'm good with that. I'm not going to call you names. But you always right. know when you win, because that's what they do. They explode and they call you names, and then yeah. and of course their tactic is to shut you up because you're making too much sense and people might hear you and they might start listening.
Well, that's I've been talking to Rick about and some other people about getting back into doing some writing. I haven't written in a long time, but I think I had my best piece of writing the other day. It was very, very early on in a debate, and I got called a Nazi.
and kudos yeah. to you. Ooh, yeah. you wrote that and, score, man. Ooh, body shot.
And so, basically, I wrote out two definitions and posted on the debate line. I said the first definition I gave was Nazi. Any person that doesn't agree with a liberal. The second definition I wrote was racist, and the right. definition for racist was see Nazi.
Yes, yes, that's great. You should.
and that's exactly, yeah, that's exactly what it is, though. I mean, it's
right, resident Nazi. Yes, yeah. absolutely. You need to, absolutely. That's a badge of honor when they call you that. Oh my gosh, good for you.
Yeah, it's for having a different political view, the left automatically wants to label you a Nazi, a racist.
And but they do that for a reason. And it's
a fear monger. I get that a lot. Yes. That I'm a fear monger.
But see, the reason why they do that is because they want to silence you. They either want to cow you into silence. They want to treat you like you're in middle school. you know, you're a little kid and you say you're bad and be quiet, and they think that maybe you'll shut up and go away, and they have to do that because if you're resonating with other people, you might actually change minds and hearts, which is, of course, that is the great American debate. That is the whole notion behind this wonderful, unique system of government that our founders created, which is a republic. That is that debate about the ideas and how we self-govern. That's our mission, is to evangelize others. In fact, I believe what we should be doing as a nation, we shouldn't, if we're talking about immigration, we shouldn't have open borders and let everyone in. We should have a of course controlled borders and have standards for who we want to come in and from any country they want to. But the reason why we want to control the borders is also because what we should be doing is exporting American ideas. We should be exporting our unique republic to these other countries. Just look at Venezuela. I mean, it's a corrupt socialist mess that's going up in flames because of its government. And all of these different governments around the world, they are in various forms of socialism or communism, and their people suffer depending on the degree of socialism and communism going on. What we should be doing as a nation, through our foreign policy, through anything that we can, through trade, is we should be exporting our unique brand of American exceptionalism, our belief that everyone is born with an innate ability to live their own life with freedom and dignity, and that rights descend from God, not government. And of course, that's why it's a threat to all of the global governing bodies, and that's why they want to corrupt America. And that's why they want to send people over here who will continue to vote socialist and vote for a bigger government, because they don't want to be dethroned. They don't want American ideas and ideology of freedom to be exported from this country. And that's what we should be exporting, in my humble opinion.
Yeah, that's absolutely correct. My ex-wife's uncle is Persian, and he's been here since the 70s. He came here to go to college, and he's been here, you know, since then. But, her aunt and her cousins have gone back with him to Iran to visit, and out in public, you know, is out in public, but behind closed doors, her cousins, the other, who are much younger than us, the other teenagers were just in awe. We have Americans here. Mm-hmm. They just wanted to know everything. They ate it all up. And that's what scares the government of Iran. That's what scares them. They do not want their people to be westernized. But the people want to be westernized.
Of course
they want. They absolutely want to. They know what it means. And
it means freedom. It means freedom from government. That's what, when they say, we don't want you to be westernized, they're using westernized as though it's some sort of pejorative, so some sort of evil is going to be done to them. No, it means you're going to be set free from government, from tyranny, from whether religious tyranny or otherwise, because we believe that we're free to have a religion or not, and that no one can tell me I must be Catholic, I must be Muslim, I must be Baptist. We believe that comes from a self-examination of our own conscience and we direct communication with God or whomever we call our God. That's what we believe. And to say westernized, that's a pejorative that these people at these governments use, as though we are some sort of, you know, we are the great Satan. We're going to steal their children. No, we're not. We're going to free them and liberate them so that they can choose for themselves, so that they can truly be adults and not children or slaves of their own government. And that's why American exceptionalism is a threat to global domination.
Absolutely. And that's what, you know, It just boggles my mind that progressives here don't see that, don't see the freedom that they have. This whole, you know, burn the flag movement last week, mm-hmm. What they don't understand is if they had the kind of government they absolutely want, they would be put in jail.
Yes.
yes. in the least for burning the flag.
For talking about burning the flag. I mean, look, just think about Cuba. I mean, you dare, you know, say anything about, you know, the most honorable Fidel Castro. You were thrown in prison. These people don't even know what it means. I mean, you cannot criticize the government, let alone burn one of its symbols. Are you kidding? What, you'd be thrown in jail or worse, you'd be shot and killed, and all of your family down to the pet goat would be shot and killed in any of these countries. I mean, they have no concept. But in their arrogance, in their little, you know, soap bubble, snowflake world with their cuddly puppies, they think that they're fighting for freedom. They don't get it. They really don't, because they haven't studied history. They probably don't know anybody who's gone through World War II. Speaking of which, we just saw how one branch of our government treats veterans. Did you see that announcement by Josh Earnest, Obama's spokesperson? And I like to refer to him, I was thinking about his name, Josh, kind of means joker, Josh Earnest, seriously. So he's like a serious joke, right? That's what it is, Josh the Joker Earnest. I mean, that's what he is. And what, I mean, he came out.
We're supposed to get over World War II.
Yeah, just
the veterans
get over
just
it.
Need to get over it. Just get over
right.
it.
Right.
It's in the
yeah.
past. Just get over
Here's
it.
Here's the quote I'm reading from. And he says, so yes, there may be some who feel
this
personally
great generation
embittered,
of Americans,
but I'm, do we have it? Oh, yes. Can we play what he said, please?
If we underestimate their patriotism and their capacity to set aside their own personal interests and prioritize the ambition and opportunity of the American people. And so, yes, there may be some who may feel personally embittered, but I'm confident that many will set aside their own personal bitterness, not because they're personally satisfied by the words of the Prime Minister, but because they recognize how important this moment is for the United States. And that's certainly why they qualify to be described as the greatest generation.
Thank you, Josh.
Jared.
Yeah, thanks, Josh. You just told the remaining survivors of the worst war in history, what, over 400,000 Americans were killed, fighting for other countries' freedom, by the way. You just told those remaining brave men and women who've survived that they should get over it. I was just flabbergasted. I love how he says personal. It's personal.
Yeah, I was going to add that.
Personal. Yes, like Persia or something. If you feel personally embittered. Good gosh. I mean, if you're supposed to be a spokesperson, can you get rid of your speech impediment? I'm sorry, I'm being nasty, but I feel bad for him because I guess he's being paid to say all of this thing. And didn't he sound he sounds so nonplus. He'd come go, well, and those who feel personally embittered, but I am confident. I mean, he sounds like he's a wet washcloth that's been sitting on the, you know, I mean, the
he really, a lot of times, I'll be honest, a lot of times, he really sounds like he does not at all want to be saying what he's saying. He really does.
Nobody's got a gun to his head making him do it. He's being paid a lot of money. I mean, if you're going to do the job, why don't you do it well or get out? But so he, anyway, but Josh the Joker Earnest, not I, I'm just not, I but you know that this is Obama, and we've got the Japanese, you know, the head of Japan coming over here, and he won't apologize, by the way. He came to mourn the souls of the victims and offer some sort of condolence, but he will not apologize. 75 years later, we're still waiting for Japan to apologize. And Josh says, that's okay. We should get over it because we're making Obama look bad, man. You veterans, you old guys, you know, you're making Obama look bad because you're not personally satisfied with the word. Shame on you, you veterans. I'm shocked and appalled, frankly.
Yeah. And to kind of move over to the other side a little bit, something that just really bugged me today is, did you see what Newt Gingrich said on Twitter?
No, I didn't. What?
He basically, and he was right in what he said, but it's just not the day to do it. He praised...
Timing is everything.
He basically praised how brilliant the Japanese were in their attack on Pearl Harbor.
Hi, Newt. Yes,
it's
okay,
not
yes.
the day. It's not it, right. correct. They it was. Yeah. It was. Yeah. It was a brilliant.
Speaking, tactically, yes, it was a brilliant. Of course, it was because they caught us totally unaware and unsurprised, and they bombed us and pretty much wiped out Pearl Harbor. Yes, okay. Technically, it was brilliant, but could you have picked a different day?
Exactly. I was flabbergasted. I was like, why today did you decide to do this?
And why is that the point that you want to leave with everybody? Why?
Right.
That of all of the things you could say about that, the greatest battle of this generation and the great generation that, you know, all of this, why say that of all things? Maybe he said other things. Maybe it's just a tweet and we're limited to 140 characters and we all do our best, but sometimes the other thing, maybe he tweeted out some other things. Maybe we shouldn't get too, you know, jumpity on him. But yeah, you're right. Japan is a brilliant strategist. Well, okay, yeah, but that's not, I'm not happy that they were. And I don't think that's something we should be. I much prefer.
It's more, it's a subject for discussion, not a subject for statement on Pearl Harbor Day. That's just kind of, you know, it just kind of, I was like, really?
Right. Timing is everything.
Absolutely.
Maybe you think he's still in the running for Secretary of State? Maybe. I've heard about, you know, they keep mentioning Romney. What do you think? What do you think about an appointment of Romney as Secretary of State?
I know there were huge differences, obviously, between Romney and Trump. And I wasn't always the biggest fan of the idea of President Romney.
Mittens wouldn't fight.
Yeah. But I think he would make a good Secretary of State. Mm-hmm. I honestly do. I get a lot of disagreement on that, but I think especially now watching him with Trump, I think he's very diplomatic. You know,
well, I will, you know what? I was just thinking, I will give you my take on a possible pick of Secretary of State Romney. I will give you my take on that after we come back from the break. And we can also talk about the loser, Jill Stein. If you'd like. And so I'll give you my take on Jill Stein and the endless recount and whether Romney is a really good pick for Secretary of State or not after we come back from the break. How does that sound?
That sounds fantastic.
Okay, great. Well, take us into the break. Since I've never done this before, you're up.
Well, like...
The following message contains a special offer for listeners of this station. Are you a man over 40? Are you constantly looking for the nearest bathroom? Do you wake up multiple times a night to use the bathroom? Right now, Perfect Prostate is sending out free bottles of their groundbreaking new formula to listeners of this station. Perfect Prostate formula was developed by medical doctor Mitchell Fleischer, and its ingredients have been clinically studied to reduce your frequent nighttime bathroom visits and promote healthy urine flow. Right now, preferred customers get their first bottle of Perfect Prostate absolutely free. There's nothing to lose. Perfect Prostate is guaranteed to reduce that constant urge to use the bathroom, especially at night, and promote healthy urine flow. Don't wait. Call now for your free bottle. Just pay shipping and processing. Dial 1-800-675-0251. That's 1-800-675-0251. Supplies are limited. One free bottle per household. Call now. Dial 1-800-675-0251. That's 1-800-675-0251.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15
$3 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
Every day, the men and women of the United States Marine Corps stand ready to defend the American way of life. The few, the proud, the Marines.
Hey folks, I want to introduce you to a friend of mine, Dr. Richard Harden. We are on the same mission, which is waking up America. We just have different paths. So stay tuned for some information on how you can keep up with Richard and all his work.
Visit Richard's website at raharden.com. That's the World Wide Web at raharden.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit Amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Harden to see and purchase his books.
Hello there, this is Nat King Cole wishing you all a happy and a Merry Christmas.
The joy of living is in the giving. So let's give lots of toys for tots. Toys, toys, toys for tots. Some have too many, some haven't any. If those who have give those who haven't, oh, what a Christmas day. The Marine Reserve will help you, will help you fill your sleigh with lots and lots of toys for tots. So give a little toy today.
Since 1947, the United States Marine Corps has been helping Santa fill his sleigh, making happier holidays for deserving children right in your community. Go to toysfortots.org and learn how you can make a difference.
Hi, everybody. Welcome back to Constitution and Culture with myself and Susan Swift. And hey, Susan, we wanted to get back into talking about your views on the
Well, I'm interested at a lot of his appointments. I know that right before the break, we had talked about Mitt Romney. Good old Mittens, who won't fight for his country against Obama. And I was nonplussed with him as a candidate back then, but he's a very honorable man. And I promised to give you my take on if it would be a good pick for Secretary of State, because they keep flirting about it and teasing it back and forth. I actually think he would be. I agree with you, Dan. The reason why is because he is a very cultured man. He has been to more board meetings and elegant places. I mean, because of his station in life, his status among millionaires, he's a businessman. He knows how to dress properly. And he also knows kind of the hierarchy of any chain of command. He would go in representing Donald Trump's position, which is, of course, the function of the Secretary of State. He won't embarrass us. He's not going to be a loose cannon with his mouth running off at saying crazy things. That is, in fact, Trump's job, as we know. I think that he would give a level of gravitas and an air of control and politeness. And so he would not embarrass anyone. He knows how to dress. He knows, which fork to use when he's eating sushi or whatever it is in front of him. He would have the culture and the self-control to be a good representative. I also think that he is one of the very better Machiavellian type choices, because he was a detractor and one of the loudest ones against Trump. Trump is very smart to consider him and possibly pick him, because that makes it makes Romney relevant. It doesn't leave him outside barking like a dog in the night. Rather, he is brought in, and he will be much more loyal as an outsider being brought in, and he will have to lick the hand of Trump, so to speak, because he will realize that, gee, I really owe him a lot. I would have been irrelevant, and now I'm being brought in. Just like in Machiavelli's The Prince describes, Trump seems to be picking some of his enemies to bring in to be part of his cabinet and things. I think that would be a smart reason why Trump would want to bring someone like Romney in. I think Romney would do a very credible job and would be honorable in it. But since we're speaking about Romney and a possible Secretary of State, which is the crown jewel, if you will, of all of the appointments, how about today we heard that Trump will nominate Oklahoma Attorney General Scott Pruitt for the head of the EPA. Oh my gosh. Oh, liberal heads are exploding all over the country tonight when they heard about that. They're frothing at the mouth. They're falling down and they're going into epileptic fits over this man because Scott Pruitt at the New York Times just tonight came out with its hit piece on Scott Pruitt. The title was just epic. It is, they call Scott Pruitt climate change denier. Dun, dun, dun.
Yeah, I thought I heard a whole bunch of M80s going off somewhere.
Yeah,
because
exactly.
I was in Asheville, North Carolina, which is North Carolina liberal central.
Oh man, they've got to be. I mean, you know what? It's so, I'm sad for the poor liberals. They believe in gun control. A lot of them are going to be kind of sad that they have gun control because they can't go find their own guns and put an end to their lives. They're so upset about Scott Pruitt. It's so funny because Scott Pruitt is the key architect of the battle against Obama's climate change agenda at the EPA. Pruitt is a staunch defender of states' rights versus the EPA. And this is a quote that he said. This is all out of a New York Times article that came out this evening on December 7th. He said, scientists disagree about the extent of global warming and its connection to actions of mankind. That debate should be encouraged. Dissent is not a crime. The liberals are going, wait a minute. And of course, it's a crime to disagree with the science, with the cult of climate change. It's a religion. To these liberals, climate change is their religion. They've got two aspects of their religion. One is that man-made global warming, aka climate change, aka the weather, it's all created by mankind, and we must therefore reduce mankind's carbon footprints. And the other tangent of that, of course, is to reduce mankind overall. The other part of their religion, their unholy sacrifice, is of course abortion. That's what they want. They have to sacrifice human beings on the altar of global warming to save Mother Earth from all of these children that they're having. It's they can't believe that now we've got a major critic of the EPA who's going to head up and he's going to dismantle the EPA. Trump has threatened to dismantle the EPA. He has said, this is now a quote from Trump. This is in the New York Times, quote, we are going to get rid of it in almost every form, unquote.
That's great because, you know,
the man to make good on those threats and the liberal, all the tree huggers and all of the recent. There are these people who like they have. I don't want to be vulgar, but they're having sex with the earth. What's the name of
those? Oh, God.
Poor mental. they're not, I guess they went off their meds. They need to get back onto their meds, but they're believing in that, you know, having sex with the earth, not with animals. I mean, that's weird too, but I mean, we're talking about with the earth. These people are probably going bonkers tonight because they think that Scott Pruitt is going to drill down into the core of the earth, unleash all of the oil and pollute all of the streams and then set everything on fire so that the entire atmosphere goes up in some big cosmic carbon cloud and we all die because of lack of sun. That's what they're thinking that this guy's gonna do. Well, and I'm
so I had a friend of mine today, and I'll paraphrase it, but he basically said, what's Pruitt gonna do? What is he going to take a giant wrench and throw it into the mechanism of the atmosphere and disrupt everything. I mean, it especially happened today, but it's been happening since the election, that I see on social media, is you don't have to troll liberals anymore. They troll themselves. It's amazing. It's amazing. The stuff I saw today. I mean, complete emotional breakdowns over this.
Oh yeah.
It's like, you know, and I mean, I see it as a win-win, because if you reduce and break down the EPA, it's going to free up a huge amount of office space in the gorgeous Ronald Reagan Building tower.
That's a good idea. Yeah. Hey, they could rent that out and make some money. But yeah.
Exactly.
Exactly. Oh my gosh. Yeah. I've already gotten a few tweets, because I just very innocently said, you know, the left is, their head's exploding tonight over Scott Pruitt, and people are just coming out of the woodwork mad that I would say that. And you know, and then they of course start calling names. It's just it's hysterical. They can't get over it. And then this is a few days ago, this is 5 days ago or so, maybe a week ago, when Trump announced his appointment of Betsy DeVos to the National Education, you know, the Department of Education. She's a billionaire and a philanthropist, so she doesn't need the money. She's not doing it for any personal gain. She has been a national leader of school choice. And school choice, for anyone who does not know what that means, it means that parents get to put their kids in private school or charter school or public school as they choose. It means that the parents have the choice. Right now, most parents don't enjoy that choice because public schools are the only thing that they can afford. Private schools and charter schools are out of reach. What school choice or vouchers would do would be to make states, the money, the taxpayer money that comes in for education, each child costs the state about, I don't know, $5,000-$7,000. Pick a figure. Say it's $5,000 per child to educate per year. That $5,000, instead of going to a local designated public school, it's tied to the child. Wherever the child is sitting and learning, that's where the money flows. And of course, the reason that the educationists, the public education people, are up in arms, this is the unions, the teachers' unions, this would break the unions, because people, parents could say, well, gee, my public school's not so good, and I really want to put my kid at you know, at the local Presbyterian, you know, church school, so that they can also learn religion. And the $5,000 will then flow to that religious school, and out of it won't go to the public school. And the public school, the teachers' unions are coming unglued, because Betsy DeVos, who's going to be the head of the Department of Education, has spent millions to promote school choice and vouchers. And she has described the current education monopoly, the current education system, as a monopoly. And she's going to inject competition because she wants to allow parents to be able to choose the best education and the right education for their children. So I think that's another brilliant pick by Trump, that I know that liberals, especially the unions, are just, they can't, it's their worst nightmare. Every morning, these liberals wake up and they're probably dreading tuning into Drudge or even CNN, because they probably wake up going, oh my gosh, yeah, or who's he gonna appoint today?
Yeah, and you know, you mentioned that school vouchers being a union buster. It's not even a union buster. I mean, when I left PG County, Maryland 13 years ago, the yearly expenditure in PG County per child in the schools was $10,500.
Ouch.
I moved down here to North Carolina. We moved where we moved for a reason. We moved down here to North Carolina. We picked a small city school system, one high school in the whole school system. And the average expenditure now is about $5,500. And every kid gets issued a MacBook Air at the beginning of the year. and they do all of their homework and everything on it. Every kid gets a computer. They have a whole system set up. They have a system called Angel where my ex-wife and I, we can go online and we can see exactly what grade our kids got on every single assignment from every single teacher.
Man, do they offer mani-pedis too? Because that's cool.
It's great. And half the money of what PG County was spending for my kids to be in a school that hadn't been painted in 40 years and the ceiling tiles were falling out and we had to supply toilet paper and paper towels.
Yep.
Administration. That's administration sucking off the taxpayer. That's having a huge school administration is what that is. That doesn't even have to do with teachers' unions.
We had,
at least through elementary school up there, we had some teachers that we absolutely adored. We had some great teachers. But it was the system that was the problem up there, you know? And we just finally said, you know, we were paying $6,000 a year in property tax on our house to pay for that.
Yeah.
We finally said, this just isn't worth it anymore. And we left.
Exactly. And the what school choice will do, and I really hope that, as a sidebar, that Trump does what he says he's going to, you know, with respect to closing the borders, installing these type of people that he's named. I hope he will do what he says, because that's why we elected him, that he would get some of these things done. Maybe not all of the things. We understand how it works, but he better get some of these done. But school choice is so very important, because it is the ideology of America, which is freedom. Freedom to choose what you want to do, pursuit of happiness. And what we should be doing is empowering parents to make the best choices that they can for their children, not locking them into some government program that we think is best. Well, your kid needs to go to this school because we say so. That's the antithesis of what America is about. School choice says, all right, we value, because We're not anti-government. We need a government to have a system of laws and to set up a society that everyone can live peaceably in. And that's why we value education. That's why it is important to have taxes to pay for education, because it is very important that all children get education and that there is a common font of knowledge that everyone can draw from. And that's what makes a culture better is education. What we have to agree on, though, is that parents know their children best. Not the government. And again, our government is always trying to act in loco parentis, in the place of the parent. And that has to stop, because we have to start trusting Americans, regular Americans like you and me. We know our kids best. And the few, okay, let's say there's going to be a handful of wacky toon loony parents who are maybe abusive or wrong or fund wacky, you know, kind of schools who are threats to other people. We'll find them out soon enough, and there are plenty of laws in all of the states and federal laws that we can scoop them up, and if we have to, if it's really necessary, we can rescue children from abusive parents. That's not the problem. The problem is we have a school system that is designed around a top-down, dictatorial, tyrannical system that thou shalt learn what I'm teaching you, and parents don't have enough input. And that's why Betsy DeVos is a good pick. And I wish her well. I'm hoping that American moms and dads will have better choice. I would love to be able to have more choices in education. I have my kids at some good schools, and I'm pretty happy with it. But boy, if I had the extra ability of the money to be able to go to different schools, what it will do is it will create a level playing field and inject competition into education. And then you'll start seeing fabulous things start happening. Teachers could go and commit, they could audition for better positions at private or charter schools. And the schools would have to start competing, offering different benefit packages, etc., to try to attract the best teachers. And they would be measured by the results of the students. And it'll revolutionize American education if we can get rid of the top-down government, you know, Department of Education control through vouchers. I think it'll be stunning. Hey, we forgot to talk about, we were going to talk about, we still have time. We need to talk about the loser of the year. Yes.
I was just going to say, we've got about 10 minutes left and we absolutely have to hit Jill Stein. We have to hit Jill Floppy Disk Stein.
Oh, yes. Tell me. You told me about that at the break. Tell me about the floppy disk. What did she say? Please.
She said that that voting machines that aren't online, are not connected in any way to the internet, can still be hacked with floppy disks. My head. I will admit, I did a liberal imitation, and my head exploded.
And where, pray tell, would we get said floppy disks?
Exactly. She point
we
blank
down
said
Radio
this.
Radio Shack and find some old dude with long hair and, you know, still wearing Birkenstocks, and he's got his personal collection in his garage. I mean,
I wanted to warn her that I was busy hacking voting machines with my ColecoVision Atom.
Yeah. Well, there. Look, these liberals are desperate. You know that. I mean, Jill Stein was put up. This is a put up job. She got less than 1% of the vote. She's raised more money. I think it's over $7 million now. She's raised more money just, you know, advertising this faux recount than she ever did as a presidential candidate. And the reason why is because I suspect, can't prove it, but I suspect the Clinton campaign and George Soros and friends are funding the campaign. And also a lot of these crybaby snowflake Democrats who just still cannot believe that the nightmare is real, that Hillary Clinton lost. And I kind of sympathize in a way because I've lived through 8 years of Obama waking up every morning and going, oh my gosh, Obama is our president. What do we do? They're finally waking up to our reality every single morning. And every day I wake up, it's another never Hillary day. And thanks to Jill Stein, we do have to give kudos to Jill Stein. Woo! Jill Stein, you know why? Because of Jill Stein, we're going to watch Hillary lose a second time. It's going to be awesome.
That's right. And I believe, if I'm not mistaken, I think it's Wisconsin. Trump actually gained votes in Wisconsin,
yes.
which is a plus. And it's but the, like you said, the waking up. The funny thing is, though, is the different reactions. You know, we've been waking up for 8 years of, oh boy, what's going to happen today? But we're mature about it. They are crying and whining. They're crying, whining, protesting, rioting. I mean, look at right after the election in Oakland, they tore their own city apart.
I know.
What is that accomplishing?
It's political insanity. They have become unhinged, and they're realizing, look, they don't even have a bench anymore. I mean, literally, I think it was Biden, Joe Plugs Biden was talking about he doesn't rule out the possibility of running for president in 4 years when he's 78. Oh my gosh. I mean, you know, that's their bench. They've got Hillary who probably has some sort of medical conditions like Parkinson's. I've written about that extensively. If not that, I mean, something else. I mean, she just does not look well. Her eyes always go wonky and she can't stop coughing and things like that. You and I have talked about it, but their bench for president in 4 years is who? The only places they can draw from are places like, you know, the fringe California. That's our, you know, our neck of the woods over here. And they're not too many. I mean, Kamala Harris has now been elevated by the election because we've got a one-party rule out here in California. So the entire bench of the Democrat Party is going to be coming from, you know, the coastal states. And they don't have a bench in 4 years. We've got look at all of the solid conservatives who actually did run in the Republican primary. I mean, we still got Cruz and Rubio and others like him, like them.
Ben Sasse.
Yes.
You know, I mean, there. Yeah. When this whole election started over a year and a half ago, and they were talking about the you know, the Republicans as all old white guys, and
that's
I was
white,
like.
I think.
But right, but then I was like, okay, well, you have Hillary, you have Biden, you have, I mean,
and who else? Bill Clinton. And there's always Bill lurking.
And, yeah,
in the
and it's just it's insane. You know, and I was looking at it and going, okay, and look, we've got Rubio and Ted Cruz and Walker and Paul. And I'm like, old white guys, what are you talking about? And they still act
Bobby
that Jindal. Way. They
st- Hello, Bobby Jindal.
Bobby Jindal.
You know,
yeah.
It's just great. We're a much more inclusive party, and I think it's hysterical. But we really do have to applaud Jill Stein for dutifully marching through the order she's got, because she's going to make a difference. Not. I mean, really, yeah, whatever she's going to do, all it's going to do is confirm once again that Trump is the president. But you know what it is all about. This is about Trump, what the press, the media, which is just another, that's the propaganda arm of the DNC, just like the KKK is the terrorist arm of the DNC, okay? The propaganda arm of the DNC is desperately looking for any way to discredit or marginalize Trump's victory. They want to say, well, he really didn't win the popular vote. And based on this recount, he really didn't win the Electoral College. Because what Jill Stein's point is, if she can compromise the vote count in those three states, what will happen is they won't be included in the Electoral College balloting. Trump will still win, even if it goes to the House. He'll be confirmed. But that way, it will give the media what they desperately want. It's the hanging Chad issue of 2000, right, of Al Gore versus Bush, you know, Bush v. Gore. But it's on steroids. They want to be able to say that Trump is not legitimate, that he is an illegitimate president, that he won by falsity and fraud, and he shouldn't have won because he didn't even win the Electoral College count. And by the way, dang bust it. How come we have to rely on that stupid Electoral College? We need to reform the Constitution anyway, because it should just be mob democracy rule. You know, people don't want to abide by the founders, by the founding fathers. They don't want to go with the Constitution. And so what they're now relegated to is legitimizing Trump.
Well, and there's the kind-hearted Democrats. The story I saw today, I was watching Fox News when I came home. They were talking to this college electorate out of Michigan who has had his life threatened if he does not change his vote to Hillary.
Oh man,
which would be against the law for him to do that.
But lock and load, baby. We, you know what? I know there are a lot of Americans who would show up and put themselves on the line with weapons in hand to make sure he was safe. That lock and load, right, baby. You threaten my life. Oh boy, that's it. That's
right.
Threatening my democracy.
Peace and love.
Yeah, where's my?
We're gonna threaten. We're gonna threaten you if you don't change your vote to Hillary. I mean,
they're crazy babies, poor things. But you know what? Look. A lot of them are aging Birkenstock gray-haired people who don't have the strength to do it anymore. But what they've done is they've vampirized our children through the university process and safe spaces and snowflakes. All they teach in a lot of colleges is this activism. They dream up they revel in the glory days of the 1960s in Birkenstocks and stuffing flowers down gun barrels and protesting the war, etc. That's what these kids have been taught now for two or three generations. So is it any surprise that that's all the college campuses know? And that is our job. Our job as conservatives and as Republicans or just fair-minded people, we need to evangelize. In a political sense, we need to politically evangelize the next generation so that they do understand that the freedoms that they do enjoy are truly only one generation away, just as Reagan said. Because without defending our freedoms, without understanding them, they can be lost overnight. And we just came very close in this last election. It was truly very close. Even the Electoral College, you know, count, you can make your case if you want, but it was very, very close, and we narrowly missed having a president, Hillary Clinton. And thanks be to God, we did not. But we have a lot of work to do for the next 4 years. Trump has to set up, and he's got to fulfill his promises on immigration especially, and a lot of the other things that he had run on. And we have to, as Americans, not only come together with a positive sense, but we also have to reach out to those who feel disaffected and who feel kind of on defensive, because most of them, Dan, they don't know any better. They don't understand the gift that they have been given of freedom. They don't understand it.
Nope, you're right.
And
they
with
don't.
That, it's time to wrap it up, and I guess we'll see you next week.
Well, that's it.